Räuspern.
Facisti picciatari di naterno, sotto fatti rammi, come vento popolare, ci danno di incommento, sotto caso usci, come vuoi, sotto casa in sani, c'è ne scinni.
Mamma mia, c'ato piccini di tenere poesia, c'ato ardente di ciotto casmaria, c'ato amore lampi, c'ame ciosonia, c'ato di un mondo che tutti s'angolia, c'ato che tutti tuccolia, c'ato di concianci sangue sangue per la via.
Santi che c'è tua nocotia, c'è tua moriloria, un camuria, c'è tua cacciati sentire di mia, c'è tua satana e c'è tua nocotia, c'è tua cacciatani, 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 c'è.
Welch wunderbar.
What a wonderful start of another award ceremony for the Anne Klein Women's Award. Warm welcome to you, guests, friends of Anne Klein, and of course, a very, very warm welcome to you, Nomarusha Bunase, this year's award winner. I would like to welcome you to this sixth award ceremony, also on behalf of my colleague Livia Cotta. A warm welcome to the Heinrich Böll Foundation. We are very pleased to see that so many of you have come tonight. And I'd like to start by presenting these wonderful musicians. They're called the duo Scolo Concello, with the singer Etta Scolo and the cello player Susanne Paul. They're singing songs from Sicily, and I think these songs also link us to both Anne Klein and Nomarusha, and they are certainly able to build a bridge between Europe and Africa. So thank you for this wonderful music. Those of you who've attended other award ceremonies of the Anne Klein Women's Award know that we start with a little film about Anne Klein and with Anne Klein. And after that, we'll hear more music from our duo, and then we will be able to hear the eulogy and the jury's statement. So enjoy the little film.
Frauen haben eine andere Vorstellung von Politik und eine andere Qualität von menschlichen Beziehungen, die sich auch in der Form der politischen Auseinandersetzung durchsetzen und zeigen wird. Anne Klein legte den Grundstein für einen neuen Stil in der Politik. Sie war Feministin, Anwältin und Notarin und die erste Senatorin in Berlin, die offen lesbisch lebte.
Anne war Feministin und das hat man immer gemerkt bei allem, was sie getan hat, bei allem, über das sie nachgedacht hat, bei allen Positionen, die sie vertreten hat.
Anne Klein war durch und durch Feministin und war durch und durch Juristin. Und sie kämpfte mit den juristischen Mitteln um die gleichen Rechte für Frauen und gegen Diskriminierung. Und sie bekämpfte insbesondere sehr leidenschaftlich, wenn Recht eingesetzt wurde, um Menschen zu diskriminieren.
1989 wurde Anne Klein unter Walter Momper im Berliner Senat, der wegen seiner Frauenmehrheit auch als Feminat bekannt wurde, Senatorin für Jugend, Frauen und Familie. Sie schwor ihren Eid mit den Worten, so wahr mir Göttin helfe.
Sie hat sich als Feministin für Frauen- und Mädchenprojekte eingesetzt, hat dafür gesorgt, dass die gefördert werden, dass die eine politische Lobby bekommen. Und sie hat als Senatorin das Referat für gleichgeschlechtliche Lebensweisen ins Leben gerufen.
Und sie hat sehr früh erkannt, dass es eigentlich darum geht, Institutionen zu schaffen, die plötzlich Kraft und Energie multiplizieren. Das hat sie dann richtig aufgenommen, immer zu gucken, wo ist eigentlich der zentrale strukturelle Hebel, der ganz viel verändert.
Anne Klein engagierte sich in der Berliner Frauenbewegung, war Mitbegründerin des ersten Frauenhauses in Berlin und stärkte die Rolle der Frauen in der Politik nachhaltig.
Ja, Anne war rational und leidenschaftlich zugleich. Sie war nicht verbissen, aber sie kämpfte mit großer Leidenschaft und glaubte an das rationale Argument. Sie hatte sehr, sehr viel Charme. Sie war sehr offen gegenüber anderen Menschen. Und ich glaube, das hat bewirkt, dass sie tatsächlich überzeugend war und viele Freunde und Freundinnen hatte.
Anne Klein war eine Person, die immer furios bei der Sache war. Also so viel und breit gelebt hat, von Journalismus bis Reiseleiterin.
Und sie war immer eine Anwältin, die sich in ganz besonderer Weise für die Mandantinnen und Mandanten eingesetzt hat, deren Vertretung sie übernommen hatte. Wirklich mehr als andere, sehr kämpferisch, sehr engagiert.
Anne Klein konnte anderen Kraft geben, sie konnte anderen Mut geben, ermutigen, sich für Frauenrechte gegen Diskriminierung einzusetzen. Also das war das Wunderbare an ihr.
Ich glaube, was sie am meisten beeindruckt hat, war doch immer, dass Personen auch den Mut haben, den Finger gegen den Mainstream in eine Wunde zu legen. Auch den Mut zu haben, Dinge, die am Anfang noch obskur erscheinen, einfach auch anzusprechen. Deshalb freue ich mich, dass es einen Anne-Klein-Preis gibt, der eines schaffen kann, nämlich Beharrlichkeit und Mut in solchen Bedingungen auch auszuzeichnen.
Damit Frauen weiterhin öffentlich für ihr Engagement wahrgenommen und gefördert werden, hat Anne-Klein den Anne-Klein-Frauenpreis gestiftet.
Ach, der Preis, das war eigentlich eine ganz unfassbare Geschichte. Also man hat ja nicht Erfahrung mit sowas. Und als es dann losging, war ich erstmal nur gerührt. Und dann war das so, dass ich wahnsinnig überrollt war von dem öffentlichen Interesse, aber auch von dem Interesse der Leute, die ich kenne. Tatsächlich haben die Themen, für die ich stehe, durch den Preis auch nochmal Aufschub bekommen. Ich habe bis heute noch Anfragen zu Themen, zu denen ich arbeite. Es gab relativ viel Zeitungsartikel und Interviews und so. Das heißt, auch für Banjing, also wo ich eben auch arbeite, war das auch sehr gut. Und auch das zu sehen, dass auch die Idee funktioniert, also das hat sie sich ja überlegt. Ich meine, sie war ja sehr krank am Ende und hat in dieser Krankheitszeit eine Idee entwickelt, die ich genial finde und die einfach auch funktioniert, also in meinem Fall auf jeden Fall funktioniert hat.
Anne Klein stiftete der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung den Anne-Klein-Frauenpreis, damit auch in Zukunft das Engagement von Frauen für Menschenrechte, Gleichberechtigung und sexuelle Selbstbestimmung gefördert wird.
Dass ich diese Einladung bekommen habe.
I'm very happy that me and Susanne Paul were invited to sing and play for you to you, and we're singing songs that are rather unknown, like for instance the next song, which is called a kuntu. In Sicily, a kuntu is just a tale, so it's a certain form of music that gives people the possibility to tell something about their life. In this case, Rosa Balestreri, who wasn't able to read or write, she got her first pair of shoes when she was 15, and she learned how to read and write when she was 20. And she was singing old songs. And one day, when she was older than 50 already, she was discovered, and she went on a tour with artists, amongst them Dario Fo. Before she died, she wrote this song, Campe Kuntu, where she tells about things that she had to experience in her life, illness, abuse, hunger, and war. But the chorus constantly says, no matter what I've experienced, I've always opened up my hands and I counted my fingers and I ran into my life. And Cante Kuntu, I'm telling these stories in order not to forget anything.
Stasera vai a corro col vento. Per apri le porte della storia, stasera voglio dar un momento, la vita, lo passato e la memoria. Stasera con la vampa dell'amore, rapo una porta morta allo dolore. C'è che ho dolore, c'è che ho tormento, che gioia, amore, per l'umanità. Non è lo chianto che aggancia lo destino, non è lo scanto che ferma lo cammino. Rapo le pugna contro l'ita, resto co sogno, scorro la vita. Canto e conto. Conto e canto, più non perdere,
baci solo per un momento, voglio scantare, spaccare i cieli per fare chiovi, chiovi ramuri. C'è tu comanda, c'è tu d'inganna, e con silenzio muto se ne sta, e lo potiri che affaccia gli potenti, e lo silenzio che ammazza gli innocenti. Rapo le pugna, conto l'ida, resto con sogno, scorro la vita. Canto e conto, conto e canto per non perdere, no, lo conto. Di guerra cresceva in mezzo delle malannate, lacrime e mutini chiangeva quanti, la mia innocenza si la sparterono tanti. Prima la gente, libri potenti, tanti su tanti, in questa società non era muri, la crescia d'ogni banna, ma lo colori, aspetti con comanna, rapo le pugna. Conto l'ita, resto con sogno, scorro la vita. Canto e conto, conto e canto per non perdere, no, lo conto.
Etta Scolo and Susanne Paul. Thank you so much. Well, friends of Anne Klein, dear Noma Rusha, dear Nolo Tando, that's Noma Rusha's daughter. She's 13 years old and she's one of her four children. And I'd also like to welcome you to Berlin. It's great to have you here. Dear Ulrike Pope, dear Barbara, guests, yes, for the sixth time, we are celebrating the Anne Klein Women's Award. And not only would I like to welcome all of you here, but there's another surprise. I'd like to extend a very warm welcome and my warmest greetings to South Africa, where we can welcome Noma Rusha's fellow companions, the Kulumani women who've gathered tonight in Tokoza, close to Johannesburg, in order to attend this award ceremony. And we'd really like to send our best and finest regards to the women in South Africa.
Yeah, Anne Klein had.
This is really what Anne Klein wanted. She wanted us to celebrate. This award ceremony usually takes place around her birthday. Yesterday, she would have turned 67. And of course, we want to honor the award winner, but we also want to celebrate Anne wherever she is. But every year, we know she's with us. With this award, Anne Klein wanted to inspire courage in women beyond her death. She wanted to bolster up women to fight for their rights and against discrimination and violence. We've seen it in the film, but we all know it, especially those who knew her. She was a pioneer for human rights, for equal rights, and for sexual self-determination. And just like Noma Rusha, she has really tried to work at the grassroots and to carry out institutionalized women's politics. We've seen this, and she was able to also link these two aspects. And I think this is something that links her with the award winners to fight for rights at different levels. We are very grateful to Anne Klein for this generous donation, because this also gives us wonderful award winners. And you may know that our goal as the Heinrich Böll Foundation is to cooperate politically with all the award winners beyond this award. And we actually are doing quite well in this, and I've reported about this quite extensively last year. Last year, we honored Gisela Burkhardt and her fellow campaigners from FemNet for their commitment to women and workers' rights in the global textile industry, especially in South and Southeast Asia. Dear Gisela, it's wonderful that you're here tonight celebrating with us. And I've really noticed that I was very emotional and moved by the fact that two award winners are here tonight. And I recall last year's ceremony, and I recall how we celebrated you last year and your work. I would also like to congratulate you on your political success of last year, especially also with regard to the most recent weeks. It's the work of FemNet and Gisela, her fellow campaigners, be they in Bangladesh or India, that really manages to show tenacity and to slowly but surely make strides ahead. And I don't know whether you've heard about it, that in Bangladesh, many trade union activists have disappeared in the prisons. And it is our task to support Gisela in her work to make sure that these women are released again. Thank you so much, Gisela, for what you're doing there. And I'm also happy that we can support CIVIDEP, a partner organization of FemNet in Bangalore. We are supporting them directly as the Heinrich Böll Foundation. I've visited them 4 weeks ago in Bangalore, so I was able to really get a first-hand impression of how these women work highly professionally together with trade union activists and the textile workers, how they fight for better living conditions and workers' rights. So it is really in the spirit of Anne Klein. The prize, the award, has its impact in very concrete terms. It creates public and political recognition and acknowledgement. It gives courage and also gives protection for courageous women's activists. Dear Noma Rusha, you are such a courageous human rights and women's activist, and the Anne Klein Women's Award is a sign of solidarity and appreciation of your long-standing work to really make sure that the injustice of the apartheid regime is not forgotten and to fight for reparations. You say of yourself that no matter where you go, you always are made a leader. And yes, you are a leader, and especially for women, and we would like to thank you for that. I recall the audio recordings from the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission that really went around the world in 1996, together with an exemplary constitution and the first democratic elections in 1994. It was this peaceful reappraisal which really set the seal on the international fame of the young democracy in South Africa. However, those who travel to South Africa today, more than 20 years later, see that the wounds that the apartheid regime inflicted upon the country have not yet healed. We are seeing very dramatic social gaps and the spatial segregation between the towns and the big townships in usually inhospitable areas still exist. The dwellers of those townships spend a lot of their income for transport. But not only that, they have to fight every day for basic services such as water, electricity, and decent sanitation. Unequal access to education and health are still a big problem, even more than 20 years after the end of apartheid. In addition to that, we are seeing scars on the soul of the country and a still deeply divided society. And this is the background against which Noma Rasha dedicates her life to the fight for decent living conditions of victims and survivors of the apartheid regime in South Africa. Some South Africans, especially those who benefited intentionally or unconsciously of the racist system, would probably prefer to make a clean break here, saying, why don't we just focus on the current problems and look ahead? But in doing that, they consciously suppress the fact that coming to terms with the past prepares the ground for a positive future. While those who've been disadvantaged historically still stay poor, as long as this is still a situation, the vision of a united and reconciled nation cannot be put into practice. This is what Noma Rasha is staunchly convinced of. Corruption at all levels of the state and the systematic undermining of democratic institutions today really don't allow for an improvement of living conditions. The rage and disappointment sees to it that many, many people take to the streets. They are calling for a cultural decolonization, for instance. Noma Rasha is not surprised about these claims. She says that if we don't know how the foundation is built, we will not understand why the walls are crumbling today. In her commitment, she always talks about the unfinished business of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Archbishop Desmond Tutu, the former chair of this commission, coined this term of unfinished business when in 2014, he criticized publicly the political omissions. So neither were the reparations to the victims of human rights violations that had been suggested by the commission paid, nor has there been an attempt to tax the wealthy people in the country. And most of the political crimes that were not subject to an amnesty have never been subject to sanctions. And this is where the Kulumani support groups comes in, with the group that is Noma Rasha's political home. The organization calls on us to take the name of the commission seriously, because it does not only contain the term truth, but also reconciliation. And reconciliation up to date has not taken place. There are 104,000 victims of human rights violations that organize themselves under the roof of the Kulumani support group. They say that reconciliation without justice is impossible. So they call for a comprehensive reparation for families and communities concerned. And here, Noma Rasha fights for a feminist perspective first and foremost. She always calls the blindness, the gender blindness of the truth and reconciliation process into question, because women have always been considered by the Commission as survivors of men, as mothers or wives. But the injustice that they had to experience, for instance, sexual violence, which her mother had to experience for herself, and which had been intentionally used as a political weapon, was not part of this initiative of coming to terms with the past. But feminists know that a violent past can be a cause for the fact that South Africa is still very violent today, especially sexual violence against women. And Kulumani also hit the headlines because they filed legal actions against international companies that made a contribution to the infrastructure of apartheid. And they were inspired, by the way, by legal actions of survivors of the Holocaust. And if you have a look at our website, you'll find more information on these actions. Kulumani's main work takes place at the grassroots level in the townships of the country, for instance, by offering counseling or practical support or mobilizing fellow campaigners who want to fight against oblivion, but not as petitioners, but rather as active citizens in a democracy. And Kulumani doesn't stop with the victims of apartheid. They also want to be active in current events. When in 2012 the South African police shot 34 miners who were on strike in a platinum mine close to Marikana, the Kulumani group and Noma Rasha personally became committed and became active with the workers and their families. It was Noma Rasha who fought for the testimonies of the widows to be accepted by the Marikana Commission of Inquiry. And she also traveled to Germany together with those widows, and she spoke at the shareholders' meeting of BASF in April 2016, one of the most important buyers of the platinum of the Lonmin mine. So Noma Rasha really fights for very topical issues. Not only in South Africa, but also the global situation shows that matters of racism or discrimination are by no way a matter of the past. And in spite of this, or maybe especially because of this, she's not experiencing the acknowledgement and appreciation she deserves. And we want to bestow the Anne Klein Women's Award on her because we are so deeply impressed, dear Noma Rasha, by your commitment and your activities. Be assured of our admiration for the very concrete protection of women, for the acknowledgement or recognition of gender-specific violence as part of apartheid against impunity, for reparations, and especially for the reconciliation by naming injustice. You are saying that you want to continue with this work until you die. You want to turn South Africa into a better country. And with all our heart, we wish you that you will continue on this road, on this path, with your fellow companions. And be assured that we want to support you also in the future, and we hope that the Anne Klein Women's Award will encourage you and show you our solidarity for your work in the future. Thank you so much, Noma Rasha. And I'm now looking forward to the eulogy by Ulrike Poppe, the commissioner of the Federal State of Brandenburg, for initiatives to come to terms with the impacts of the communist dictatorship. You've got a lot in common, and I'm looking forward to your speech, Ulrike, and thank you so much that you followed our invitation, Ulrike.
Liebe
Dear Norma Russia Bonasa, dear friends, guests, it is a great honor for me to participate in honoring such a courageous and laudable woman like Norma Russia with a eulogy here tonight. Norma Russia, with her tireless fight, is committed to fostering justice and truth, to overcome the discriminations that are still happening after the end of the apartheid regime. Look to South Africa was a sentence that you could hear in Germany in all forums in the 1990s that dealt with coming to terms with the GDR past. Apartheid victims can forgive. The country is embarking upon a path of reconciliation. Victims and perpetrators are liberated and wounds are healed, was said. And this call mainly came from those who wanted to keep the Stasi files closed and who were demanding general amnesty. But it wasn't that simple in Germany, and it is not that simple in South Africa either. Without any doubt, the work of the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission deserves great appreciation and respect, because this seemed to be a path that was able to overcome the deep division of society. In fact, they started, and I quote, to transcend the divisions and strives of the past, which generated gross violations of human rights and a legacy of hatred, fear, guilt, and revenge. That was the reasoning of the commission. If we take a look at today's South Africa, however, we begin to doubt about the success of this 2.5-year commission's work. It turned out that coming to terms with the past is a long and very complex process that cannot be crossed off the list within or after 30 months. There is no way to deny the crimes committed during the apartheid after the victims or the survivors shared their sufferings and after the perpetrators admitted their crimes. But the former rulers and their henchmen basically got off lightly. The white beneficiaries of apartheid could return into their powerhouses without remorse. And of course, this left bitterness with those who had hoped so much for fair compensation. For the sake of truth, justice was sacrificed, was said by those disappointed. With the end of the commission, the door to the past, however, couldn't be closed. Forgetting cannot be prescribed. The victims of apartheid organized themselves in Kulumani and held on to their demands. Legal and social coming to terms with the past has to continue. The Kulumani Support Group was founded back in 1995. It started as a women's self-help group, and it committed itself to fostering the truth and reparations. Nowadays, they have 104,000 members, and it has become the biggest grassroots movement in South Africa. Kulumani gives those a voice that still suffer from the burden of the past of the apartheid time, and Kulumani demands compensation by the government for them. She sues former supporters of the apartheid regime, companies and banks for compensation. I feel connected to Norma Russia in various ways. We both deal with the legacy and the burden of former regimes. We try to contribute to name the injustice of the past and to acknowledge the suffering of those who were affected by it. And we are committed to making sure that through reparation and compensation, the consequences of repressions are mitigated. But there are also decisive and crucial differences. Germany's rehabilitation laws guarantee legal claims, even though it is not satisfying for all groups of victims. But my colleagues and myself are paid by the government, and we have a budget available that we can use in order to also fund other initiatives in this field. Noma Russia with Kulumani depends on herself. You have to fight in order to get heard. You and they sue the government for the reparations that they had promised. These reparations have not yet arrived with the victims. Noma Russia is national coordinator with Kulumani. And Kulumani means speak out. Take the floor, speak up. The TRC started to break silence, but this process will not end until discriminations continue for the apartheid victims, until not all crimes have been named, and as long as many people still have to live in social plight. The continuing and obviously aggravating polarization of the South African society resulted in the healing process beginning to falter. Noma Russia Bunase with Kulumani is committed to getting political recognition of the injustice that was done to women. She experienced in her own life what suppression and plight means. When her mother was pregnant with her, the mother was raped by the apartheid henchmen. Her father, a miner, found the mother lying in her own blood, and last minute he could save the life of the mother and child. That was back in 1966. After that, her mom delivered her prematurely. Already as a child, she understood that she would fight her entire life. And her fight began with the following. She didn't want to accept the inferior Bantu educational system for black Africans. She achieved to attend school faster than other black children, and she made two classes per school year. At high school, she was politically active. She encouraged her school and classmates to show protest against injustice. She would have loved to attend university, but her parents couldn't afford such an education. She found a job in a transport company where she, according to her conviction, she fostered union organizing of workers. During the violent clashes against the miners of Johannesburg back in 1993, that was before the beginning of democratization, her brother was killed. Women, according to the African culture, did not have a right to look for family members in the mortuaries. Noma Russia summoned up her courage and eventually prevailed. Between all the corpses, men, women, and children, she eventually found her brother. She prevented him from disappearing in a mass grave. Noma Russia, after initial hope, was disappointed by the TRC. Sexual violence, and this is what Barbara has already mentioned, was not an issue. There was silence regarding rapes. The recommendations of the TRC to the government, especially with regards compensation and reparations, were hardly ever implemented. Obviously, you need massive social pressure exercised by civil society in order to remind the current rulers of their promises and obligations. Kulumani demands reasonable support for the groups affected. Kulumani supports and fights for the acknowledgement of the suffering that was triggered by racial fanaticism. Here in Europe, It's very difficult for us to imagine how much courage, power, and stamina it takes to really prevail and do something against those who sit in the upper levels of society and who, like the township poet James Matthews says, give a damn about the poor and unemployed and homeless masses. But Noma Russia is a fighter. She has always been a fighter her whole life. She raised four children. She lost her husband, yet she never gave up. The deeper root cause of the massacre against the strikers of the Marikana mine in 2012, she sees in the continuing unequal living conditions. 34 mine workers were shot by the police. They left families behind in great plight. Kulumani gives them a space to name and disclose their pain, their grief, and their despair. Kulumani makes it possible for them to participate in the investigation commission established by the government. And they offer trauma healing workshops where they can express their suffering in graphical manners. In the interpretations of the images and pictures, they describe their fears of the future and also their expectations to the government. The pain is deep and is burning and doesn't want to disappear. You could read in one of those descriptions. All the promises that the government and Lon Min made to the families of the men that died during the massacre, they didn't keep vis-a-vis myself and my children. Yet I won't give up. I will ask Kulumani and my lawyers to pronounce my demands. I will put on my husband's boots and I will fight for my human rights. I hate the South African police, was written by another victim. I will never forgive Lon Min and the mining industry that they made us poor and that they took our beloved away from us. We will eventually raise our voice. That sounds like no reconciliation. And those who read the stories will understand why there is no word about reconciliation in this context. Reconciliation requires the situation where you come to terms with guilt, where you admit guilt. And coming to terms doesn't only mean to find out what happened, but it always has to be connected to the goal to liberate the common future of this burden. The term reconciliation has a biblical root cause in the word penance. Showing penance means discharging guilt. And guilt can be discharged best by helping the families affected, by making it possible for them, despite the painful loss, to lead a socially integrated life in dignity. The majority of South Africans, however, is still working for a better life. With the social upheaval of 1994, the beginning of democratic reforms, racial mindsets and behavior showing contempt for humanity did not disappear overnight. We know that from Germany after the end of the Nazi time and after the fall revolution of the GDR, dispositions from authoritarian regimes have a long-lasting impact. By the way, not only with the beneficiaries of the past regime. All the more, what we need is patient efforts and many small steps to disclose sustaining injustice and to demand human rights standards. As long as discrimination and a lack of perspectives continue, the idea of reconciliation remains abstract. Noma Russia encourages women in particular not to just accept their situation, but to raise their voices against the deprivation of their rights, to break the silence. The interest in the apartheid past is dwindling in society. Roma Russia, together with Kulumani, fights against forgetting and asks the government and society to confront themselves with the legacy of the past. Her colleague at Kulumani, Mayuri Dobson, describes her as follows. Roma Russia is a person with a deep sense for justice and the conviction that the fight for justice will eventually bear fruit. A woman who shows and presents possibilities for an equal future, who intensively listens. She has the ability to mobilize other people to raise their voices. Roma Russia helps other women to find their way out of their victim's role, to become active themselves, and to really focus on the future of their own lives and take it into their own hands. She heads an organization that contributes to heal the deep wounds of the apartheid regime. South Africa under the apartheid had supporters in major parts of the Western world. And this should oblige us to also fight for the mitigation of the consequential damages. Also, the West has to render reparations. I hope that this award will result in Roma Russia and Kulumani get even more public attention and thus get even more support. I'm pleased, dear Roma Russia, and I would like to thank you for being here. And I would like to thank you for instilling optimism and courage with your actions. Thank you for encouraging us to believe in a better world. I wish you a lot of energy, health, tough fellow campaigners, and a successful life at all levels. I congratulate you with all my heart to this Anne Klein Women's Prize. Thank you. Last year, we were asked to write music for a book. This is a book that contains only interviews conducted with survivors of a disaster in Massenel on the 8th of August, 1956. 262 miners died. 136 of them were Italians, but the big disaster also is that many women remained widows. Many kids remained and became orphans. These kids did not only get nothing, but they had to pay for the costs of the lawsuit. There was no guilt, it was said. And what really impressed me deeply was the story of women. And the following song, this quiet song, tells the story of three women. That was the interview of a young woman who said that the money that she got from the government as an infant was put on a bank account. The interests, of course, went to the government. And when she turned 18 and eventually got the money, she couldn't buy a house. She could only buy the dress for the wedding. Just a small detail. But the story of this woman impressed me because it tells us about her birth. She was born on the day when her father was buried. The grandmother did not only lose her son, the son, but also the brother in the mine. She went to the funeral, but then she decided to go to the woman the wife of her son in order to help her to deliver the child. The grandmother so decided between life and death. And in this tragic moment, she decided to live. Okay, so now I have a song dedicated to the saint of Palermo, Rosalia. Everybody says that they saved the city from off the pest. She is really loved by everybody. There were sort of almost revolutions because the church and the government wanted to limit the celebrations to 3 days. And there was a war in the city. They said, no, we at least need to celebrate a whole week. And this holy Celia, I mean, I think she was an independent woman. She was the daughter of a known prince. She was really beautiful, blonde, and she decided to live her whole life, her own life, in a grotto in the mountains around Palermo. Maybe she was a feminist, who knows? No matter what, we are going to sing this celebrating song now.
Rosa, 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 Rosalia, verba et moto, va per sacra. Rosa, 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 Rosalia, buccinetta borda, aura e nappa. Rosa, 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 Rosalia, pappa e foto, rosa e barco. Rosa, 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 Rosalia, pompa e luminaia.
Rosalia, yes.
Rosa, Rosalia, we are now saying no more Russia, please come up on stage. We would really like to hand over the award now.
Russia. Ihr könnt ruhig stehen bleiben. You know, this is already your applause before you got the prize. Can you imagine what will happen in a few seconds? So, thank you very much for your work. thank you very much for all the women you are working together with in South Africa. We are impressed and we are very happy that we have the possibility to stay and spend the evening together with you and afterwards get some more information about your work. We are proud to have you here and we are proud, and I'm sure Anne Klein would also be, that you get her Anne Klein Prize. All the best and thank you.
Sanbonani, Sanbonani, Molweni. I would like to greet you in a South African way. Of when I say Sanbonani, you say Yebo. Sanbonani, Sanbonani. Thank you. Amandla. When I say Amandla, say away to Amandla. Amandla. Long live the spirit of Anne Klein. Long live. Long live the spirit of Anne Klein. Long live. I am very happy. I am very happy to be honored and to be here also. I also thank you people from all these different areas which you have made sure that you leave your important task, your important work. You say, let me go and attend this ceremony, which is going to be awarded to somebody whom you don't know. To me, it shows exactly that there are some women, there are some humanity around Germany. Because if you, it was not like that, you were not supposed to be here. So it's first thing which I wanted to say, to thank you for honoring, to make this day successful. I also like to thank this foundation. Then Henrik Boll Foundation. Perfect. And also the whole group of children, it's manages to come together and sit down and scratch and try by all means, doing a hard work of trying to come up with a name, to come up with a person whom they will hand over and give this award to. I think it was not an easy task. I know that there are so many women outside there who are working hard, trying their best to fight for the women's rights, working hard to fight for justice in the world. That's why I am saying, when they were doing scratching, trying to persuade each other to say whom we must give this award to, it was not an easy task. The worst part, which I think the jury did work hard, they did not know, most of them did not know Noma Rashia. And then you can see Noma Rashia is so ugly. Once they look at it, they say, who is this Noma Rashia? But they did not want to check who is Noma Rashia. They check what is Noma Rashia doing. They went as far as going deeper and deeper. When you are going to get a diamond, you work hard. You don't get a diamond which is sitting on the earth. You have to scratch and dig, and you take out all the soil. You penetrate, you go down, and then you come up with the diamond, which is the brightest and something which you were trying to get. That's how the jurors were working hard to go down and try to scratch out and to get exactly this diamond which they are looking at. I am coming from the grassroots level. I am an ordinary person who is not a professional, but now today, this award makes me to be the best of the best of the people, because they have looked down and find that even at the dust root area, there are people who can make the change. It is an honor to Henry Bouts Foundation and also to the jurors not to select a person by the way of knowing or by the way of seeing and looking at the professional. There is a gap between the professional people and the poor of the poorest who are coming from the grassroots level. Today, this organization has started to close the gap and has started to teach everybody and even the world to say that you must not think that an ordinary person does not have a creative ideas, cannot come up with the ways of transforming, cannot be part, and we learn from each other. We as Kuluman Support Group, being at the grassroots level, we are saying that we are the governors who can try and bring the change, who can also direct the leaders to look at the issues of injustice and also to look at the unfinished business of the people at the grassroots level. Together we can make change. It's not about you think and do for people without people. You have to work together. Thus, I don't want thank you. I don't want to talk so much because a lot has been said about the work which we are doing and the work which I'm doing as a Noma Russia for social justice, for economic justice, for political justice and cultural justice. All what we are doing, we say that we are the university of the grassroots root level, whereby the university from the professionalism can come and also learn from that university, which does not have a name, but we do have a name. We are proud to say we have a university of the grassroots level, whereby we create a platform of dialogue. We create a platform of discussion. We create a platform of making the transitional justice. Being the group of the victims and survivors, we don't sleep and say we need reparation. We need just to depend. We want to make sure that the whole world, the citizens of each world, become an active citizen to guide the leadership towards justice, towards humanity. We would say the past brings present for the future. Without knowing that stand, you won't know where are you going to. I don't want to say more things. Thank you. Thank you.
Liebe Noma Russia.
Dear Noma Russia, this very, very old song is for you. It is a Sicilian story, which is quite different from all the other tales, really. Because in the olden days, these Sicilian women were married at the age of 14 or 15, and then it was over. Now, this tale from the 17th century goes as follows. The girl says, I don't want to marry this prince. I don't want to wear the crown. I'm against this. And she goes to the square of the village and she screams very loudly that she is not willing to become a princess.
Chi cantare che festa ci fa
la vie.
Anita Scolo, Susanna Powell, thank you very much for this wonderful music. I can't get enough. Thank you very much. And allow me to say a few more words of thank. I would like to thank Ulrike Poppe for the wonderful eulogy. Thank you very much. I think you built a very nice bridge to your own work and Numa Rush's work, and I hope that you will become friends, not only in spirit. Dear Numa Rush, thank you very much for your words of gratitude. I told you that we will cooperate even more intensively in the future with you. And then there are many, many people, women, who organized this evening here. And I would like to thank Ulrike Zichon for organizing this, like every year. She holds the award together, sort of. She also builds bridges to our award winners. Thank you. Now, this year, I would also like to thank the Africa Department of the Heinrich Böll Foundation. Dear Kirsten Maas-Albert, dear Maria Kind, should she be here, thank you very much for your support. Thank you for organizing this. Such an award winner was not part of your budget. It was sort of imposed on you because the jury made the decision. All the more, it is great that you did everything to organize such an event and evening. And you will have noticed that we have an office in Cape Town. And I would like to thank Paola Adjibushi in particular. Please get up for a second. She was our contact. She was available at any time, and she has been accompanying Numa Rush the whole time. There were some difficulties with entering the country, for instance. A lot of stuff that had to be handled. Paula, thank you very much. Thank you for your support. A celebration doesn't work without drinks and food and music. So I would like to invite everybody now to join us in our flying buffet. We will have drinks and snacks. We will then have Andrea, our DJ. We always dance. And I am looking forward to dancing with Numa Rush later. But before that, thank you very, very much for coming. It is wonderful. It is your support that helps us here, that helps Numa Rush, that helps our work. Enjoy the evening, celebrate, and stay here as long as you can. Thank you very much.